Android 11 is on the way officially because there is a beta program out there that you can sign up for. Now, whether or not you should is what's on the channel today. Hello automators, thanks for tuning in again. I'm Brian from Automate Your Life, and today I'm going to take the frustration out of automation and out of owning a Pixel or an Android device as we walk through all the latest updates and upgrades that we're getting, not just with Android 11, but with the operating system as it stands today. Although Google sold 7.2 million Pixel devices last year and actually passed by OnePlus in terms of phone sales, they are still a long way from Samsung and Apple in terms of catching those two companies. But what they are continuing to do is provide kind of mid-range options, and it looks like they're really going to do that even more this year. And why I'm talking about this is actually some surveys that came out very recently and were obviously directed at the Pixel 4a and the Pixel 5 and the market that they're trying to hit. Now, what has happened as of late is, you know, we've all been sitting here waiting, and I've been waiting for the Pixel 4a for a while. I mean, really since I had the Pixel 3a, because of just how good that phone was on a very good budget price. I really was looking forward to seeing what they would do with the 4a, but it doesn't look like that $350 starting point phone will show up until around August of this year. And unfortunately, the Pixel 5 looks to be delayed until October. Now, we are all trying to get a lot healthier, and we're trying to do it with minimal effort. I mean, that's what I'm trying to do. But one of the ways that I've been looking at trying to get a little bit healthier in my life is through a scheduled bedtime routine, or basically creating a bedtime routine that allowed me to create a consistent schedule. And we all know that that's really important for our overall health. Now, inside of the clock application, Google has actually created some great functionality that's just come out recently. And you will see this bedtime tab down at the bottom. Now, what's really great about this is you can actually set a schedule, and this schedule can be set by day. So if you want to kind of take the weekends off like I do, you can see I've turned off the weekends there. I just turned on Sunday again. But there's also reminder notifications and a bedtime mode. Now, this bedtime mode is really interesting. When you turn it on based on schedule, then at 11:30 p.m., which you can see is my start time for my bedtime, then it will actually turn the whole phone to grayscale and turn on do not disturb mode. You can see those settings at the bottom. Now, you can also do it when it's charging at bedtime, but it's still going to use that schedule in order to show you some statistics, which I'll show you in a minute. Now, the sunrise alarm is a really interesting feature, and you know, people spend a lot of money on getting Philips Hue lights and getting a whole wake up routine set where the lights come on slowly over time. Well, that's exactly what happens with that. And it basically brings up a very red screen over time that will brighten your room quite a bit. It's actually fantastic. Now, you will then have the alarm go off, which you can choose the sound and whether or not it vibrates. And then for me, I love the Google Assistant routines with these kinds of alarms. You can find out all kinds of information. When you dismiss this alarm, I get the weather, the calendar, reminders, and then if I'd like, I could play some different content down below. So there's other things you can do too, but I love these Google Assistant routines. Now, as I go back to the main page of the bedtime page, there's a couple more things here. You can see the recent bedtime activity, and as I tap through, you can see where I've been using my phone, even in that grayscale mode, after my bedtime or just before my wake-up time. Now, I actually adjusted my wake-up time to 8:30 here just the last day, but this was basically tracking at 7:30 and showing me all of these different statistics. Now, the other thing that I really enjoy is the sleep sounds. And I say that because you can actually go in and you can set a stop time. So it will stop making the sleep sound after up to an hour. So this creates a really smooth routine, and it already has in my life. And I'm already seeing some of the benefits in terms of my sleep schedule. I want to show you another application, and this is extremely powerful. This is called the personal safety application, and this is something relatively new. You would have been able to get this around the start of June. Now, what it can do, number one, as soon as you get into the application, they ask you to name from your contacts some emergency contacts, and you can always adjust that in the settings later. Now, you also get the ability for car crash detection to turn that on. That's in the US right now. You can also add in a number of medical information components, and these things can show up. So you can change the setting when your phone is found. If you're in a bad way, well, you can actually get people to see this kind of information, including things like your allergies and your blood type and any medications that you're on. Now, with that and the emergency contacts that you're going to give them access to, they can get to all the different people and all the different information they need in order to help you. Now, there's also a crisis alerts when you first come into the application that you can turn on, and that's based on local information. Now, they don't guarantee they're going to give you every local crisis alert, but it's Google and they do have a lot of access to a lot of information. But my favorite component to this, and I think every one of us has a friend or a family member like this, and they go out for an early morning run on their own, or they go out for a late night walk, or they're out doing different things late at night, and we oftentimes have to wait for them to call in order to know that they're okay. Call or text. You can hit the emergency sharing button, and this will share your real-time location with your emergency contact. So you can just hit that, hit share, and you can put in a reason if you want, but you don't have to. And that will actually send text messages to your contacts and let them know that you're emergency or in an emergency state and you're sharing your location with them. Now, you have to share your map location, of course, but the safety check is really that person, right? They're walking alone, they're going for a run, they're taking transportation, or they're going for a hike, or they can write their own reason for what they're doing, and then they can set a duration for how long between now and the end of that event is, or that activity that they're going to undertake, that they want to basically have as free time. So let's say they're going for a 30-minute walk, they set the duration as that. They choose the people that they would like to let know. They hit turn on, and now in 30 minutes, if you do nothing with your phone, then those people will be notified that something has gone wrong with you and that they should basically check in. They'll get your emergency shared location. And you can see there's a call 911 button on the bottom here. It's a very comprehensive app. So what they have to do in order to stop the emergency sharing from going off is hitting that turn off button. Now, what I'll also tell you is that when safety check is on, you can see it right here, you can start emergency sharing or call 911. So you don't have to keep the app open as you go for your run. You don't have to worry about pocket dialing 911 because you can actually close the app, or at least turn off the app. And then that would be your quick way for getting to call 911 or start emergency sharing with your emergency contacts. Something I personally do a lot of is actually transcribing these kinds of scripts. So I kind of prep this a little bit before I come and sit in front of the camera and talk to you guys about whatever we're talking about that day. Now, the recorder app has become paramount in that within my Pixel phone. And this application has actually got some recent updates that are so important, I think, and they're through the Google Assistant. Now, what you can actually do is through the Google Assistant, start and stop recordings as well as actually search the recordings. And that is something you could do by typing in the search bar, but now you can search by voice in your recordings. Having really great accessibility for everyone is such an important component of smartphones. And since Google I/O 2019, Google has really been focusing on this. Now, they have actually put out a tool that not only really improves accessibility, but it actually can create a lot of productivity in your life in a very quick way. Now, this is something that I think has been missing from smartphones, and widgets were really intended to kind of help with that. And we see Apple taking on widgets a little bit at this point with their iOS system, but and Google's had it within Android for a long time, but widgets never went far enough. Well, you can enter in to what is called action blocks at this point. And this application, I think, is so important. Even though it is really just intended initially as accessibility, what it gives you access to is your entire smart home and the entirety of the Google Assistant. So anything you can write into Google Assistant or anything you can say to Google Assistant, you can create a one-tap button that will help you manage your entire life. Now, we have created a number of tutorials, and there will be a much larger video here where you actually get to see the interface that I have created to manage not just my smart home, but my smart life in general. So the question as to whether or not to join the Android 11 beta is a pretty tough one. And I'll tell you that it came down to one thing for me. But first, I want to tell you what some of the features are that enticed me to actually look at this, because there are actually well over 100 features coming to Android 11 that we do not have on Android 10. Now, the first one that's really big for the smart home audience is a smart home control panel, or a home power control panel. Now, as you hold the home button in the new version or the new Android 11, you'll actually get to an interface to control your smart home, everything from lighting to vacuums to thermostats and really a lot of other devices throughout your home. That's a really enticing feature that I want access to today. I'm also really looking forward to an AI-based feature that will read the content on your screen, and then if you're asking questions to it by voice, you are going to get contextual answers. So it will understand what you're talking about on the screen, and you're going to be able to have a much better conversation about what's going on with your Google Assistant. I'm also really excited for, simply put, bubble notifications for messages. So, you know what? I use Facebook Messenger in a lot of cases because I get that little bubble notification that I can move around the screen and switch between conversations. I also really like the idea of the trash can that is going to be put in place for applications. It means they can delete files or basically remove files without fully deleting them for about 30 days, but then they're going to go away. So this is going to become a really important component of managing space. And we all know lots of the Pixel devices don't have a lot of extra memory on them. But what this came down to in the end for me was a read through the terms and conditions of that beta program. And if you go and you join the beta, well, it's expected that you're going to run into a few bugs. Now, as a smart home user, or a heavy smart home user, and someone who has hundreds of applications on my phone, what I have already heard of is a number of bugs that do exist. And this obviously gets better as the beta goes on longer and longer. They have less and less bugs, they have less and less major issues, but people are running into issues that they just cannot live with. And unfortunately, what has happened to a number of my friends and colleagues is that they have had to actually go and revert out of Android 11. Now, what that does to your phone at that time, if it is your primary driver, well, your phone is fully reset, it's fully factory reset, and you've got to start fresh. Now, obviously, there's some things attached to your Google account at that point, but not everything, and you're potentially losing a lot in that moment. So to me, it came down to that. I want to be able to show you guys everything I need to be able to show you on the channel, and I want to be able to make sure I can make a phone call at all times, and when you read the fine print there, that's not necessarily guaranteed. One of the most important apps that I didn't have a couple years ago is Google Duo. And I say that because I'm using that application like crazy. I'm making video calls, I'm making audio calls, I'm calling friends and family on smart displays, as well as on my Pixel or my Android devices. And I used to be able to use it on my iPhone when I had that. So it's all over the place. But what has recently happened is actually a director from Google came out and said, hey, we're ready to announce that up to 32 people can go and have a video chat on Google Duo on a Chrome browser. So that's the feature that they rolled out. Now that's well and good, but I had to ask the question and I actually got a response right away about whether or not we would see this show up on all devices. So 32 participants will come to all platforms for Google Duo video calls. And I think that's going to be a really interesting experience on a device like a Pixel smartphone. For many years, I have absolutely loved Google Play Music. And there's one specific reason for that. And that is that I was able to upload all of my musical content to that service a number of years ago. It was seamless, it was quick, it was easy, and it was free even. And then I had access to all of my music everywhere. But I got a little bit nervous here when I started to see the things start to shift over to YouTube Music a couple of years ago. We saw that service pick up steam and we saw more and more users start to use YouTube Music. And then it became clear that Google was going to switch over and I worried about all of that music that I had uploaded. But there is finally a full transfer tool that many people can use around the world, and you just need to go to that URL, log into your account, and most of you will be able to actually get your music transferred across to YouTube Music. And at that point, you can start using that service to do a lot of the same things that you were doing with Google Play Music. With us all being such heavy users of the voice assistant, the Google Assistant, I think it's pretty safe to say that you have some Google Home or Google Nest devices in your home. And if you do, then you want to get the most out of those through a very similar update video to this. That video is up on screen now. You can go check that out. There are a ton of updates for that whole ecosystem. Otherwise, guys, thanks for watching. And of course, don't hate, automate.